on February 27th, 1941. February 27th, 1941. Our ambassador to Japan, Joseph Grew, sent the following encoded message to our State Department. My Peruvian colleague told a member of my staff that he has heard from many sources, including Japanese sources, that the Japanese military forces plan, in the event of trouble with the United States, to attempt a surprise mass attack on Pearl Harbor, and they will use all their military capabilities. He added that although the project seems fantastic, the fact that he has heard it from so many different sources prompted him to pass on the information. This is but several war warnings that our military and political leaders received, not to mention General Billy Mitchell's prediction almost down to the minute of the attack on Pearl Harbor. In fairness, our country also faced possibility threats from Japan in the Philippines, Indochina, and Formosa. Our guest speaker today will hopefully help clear the fog of war about the infamous attack on Pearl Harbor. And just a little bit about our guest speaker today. Thomas Kimmel is a graduate of the United States Naval Academy, former FBI agent, and is the grandson of Admiral Husband Kimmel, who was our commander of the Pacific Fleet on December 7th, 1941. Admiral Kimmel was, according to Tom, shamelessly scapegoated, reduced in rank, and disgraced after Japanese attack. Kimmel comes from a family of distinguished scholars and government service dedicated to protecting America. So Tom found it particularly troubling that his grandfather was accused from the well of the House of Representatives for having failed to prevent both World War II and the Cold War. Tom has devoted years of his life to the study of the topic and uses these speaking opportunities to respond to the allegations. Tom Kimmel served on three warships during the Vietnam War and attended John Marshall Law School before beginning his FBI career in 1973. He served the FBI and the nation with distinction for 25 years. He's investigated organized crime in Cleveland, served on the House Appropriations Committee surveys and investigations staffs at CIA headquarters, and ended his FBI career as Assistant Special Agent in charge of the Philadelphia Division, heading the foreign counterintelligence and terrorism programs during the first attack on the World Trade Center in 1993. Since retiring, Tom has served, as well as in other capabilities, as a consultant to the FBI Bureau on major spy scandals, as both the FBI and the CIA. When I talked to Tom this morning, I said, gee, Tom, is that all? He said, just remember, Pete, I get the mic after you. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Tom Kimmel.
Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Can you hear me in the back? I think that was a yes. Pete Mecca, thank you, sir, for that effusive, inflated, hyperbolic introduction that I provided for you. Stay with me, folks. I promise you some facts you have never heard before. I promise you some free stuff. I promise you an investigation. And hopefully, some fun along the way. After all, it is my job today to talk. It is your job to listen. Ladies and gentlemen, should you finish before I do, then God bless you. This is the story within the Pearl Harbor story. But before we go any further, the first thing we want to do is fix responsibility. Let's cut to the chase here. Let's make no mistake. Let me be clear. We are here today to fix responsibility for the success of the Pearl Harbor attack. To do so, I have found it very useful to engage in this exercise. Bear with me. Pete Mecca and Dick Hyde, Dick, would you raise your hand? And Dick Hyde are responsible for having me here today in the same sense that Admiral Kimmel and General Short were responsible for their job in Pearl Harbor on December 7th, 1941. In the sense that Dick and Pete had to properly respond to information they had in getting me here today. What have we learned so far? Not too much. Consider this. Dick Hyde and Pete Mecca are accountable for having me here today in the same sense that Admiral Kimmel and General Short were accountable at Pearl Harbor, in the sense that they had to properly account for everything they did and did not do in getting me here today. We still need a little more. The real question, ladies and gentlemen, should Pete and Dick be blamed for having me here today? And ultimately, for you to decide, ladies and gentlemen, should they be punished for having me here today? Okay, why am I here? Who am I? This is my first ship out of the Naval Academy, my second ship, my third ship. This represents my 25 years in the FBI, and I'd like to point out that the lower right-hand picture is a picture of me when I entered the FBI in 1973. The picture in the top center was my escort badge after 25 years in the FBI. I show you this to give you some idea what happens to you after 25 years in the FBI. Here's why I'm here. There's a story within the Pearl Harbor story. It's the story of a nation under attack for 5 years, to be sure. But it's also the story of a man under attack for well nigh 75 years. That man is my grandfather. I am his eldest grandson. He has been humiliated, disgraced, and scapegoated for nearing 75 years. There's a story within the Pearl Harbor story, and this is certainly part of the story. That's my dad, Naval Academy, 1936. That's Admiral Kimmel, Naval Academy, 1904. That's my dad's older brother, my Uncle Manning, Naval Academy, 1935. And this is my great-grandfather, class of 57. That would be 1857 out of West Point. And indeed, my great-grandfather fought the First Battle of Manassas, or Bull Run if you prefer, for the United States Army. But he was from Kentucky. After the battle, he resigned his commission, went back to Kentucky to consider his options. And he opted to fight the rest of the war for the Confederate States Army. And fight he did. He fought at Vicksburg, Holly Springs, Corinth, Pea Ridge. He fought with Magruder's Raiders and a host of other lesser engagements and miraculously survived the war. Or we would not be having this conversation this today. These are the three submarines on the left that my dad was on in World War II, also miraculously surviving the Battle of Lingayen Gulf on submarine S-40. That's my dad. His older brother was on the three submarines you see on the right. He was on Drum at the Battle of Midway, the most important naval battle in the history of the American Republic. He was on Raton as the executive officer, that's the number two officer, when she was fired upon in the South China Sea by the USS submarine Leipan. Two torpedoes bounced off the hull of Raton, but the torpedoes did not explode, or my uncle would have been killed outright at that time. This was testament to the scandalous situation in the United States Navy for the first 2.5 years of the war. The short of it is, as a general proposition, our torpedoes did not work, which of course almost killed my dad at Lingayen Gulf. My uncle was promoted to commanding officer of Robolo. And in 1944, right in the middle of Admiral Kimmel's Naval Court of Inquiry, Robolo was reported overdue and presumed lost. That presumption exists today, as nothing was ever recovered. The Chief of Naval Operations, Admiral King, came into the proceedings of the Naval Court of Inquiry and declared that the proceedings would be closed for one day out of deference to Admiral Kimmel's loss. While all that was going on, my mother, Nancy, pictured here, was in Medan, Sumatra with her family. Just prior to the Pearl Harbor attack, her mother, Bernice, sister Mary, and sister Sue were evacuated to Australia. But my mother, after the Pearl Harbor attack, was still in Medan, Sumatra. A British general went to my maternal grandfather, William Stanley Cookson, and said, "Will, whatever you do, get Nancy out of Sumatra because the Japanese are about to take the island." If I had time, I could tell you a marvelous story of escape, but I don't have time for this talk. I do have 8 other talks, however. At any rate, the order went out from the British, women and children were to leave Sumatra immediately. And they did. My uncle Lynn, at the time, age 16, was not considered a child, so he was not to be evacuated. And of course, my grandfather Lynn, Will, was not to be evacuated either. Nenda refused to go. As a consequence, these three were taken prisoner of war by the Japanese for the entire war. Gentlemen, ladies too, consider first the difficulties of being a prisoner of war for the entire war, and then consider being a prisoner of war with your mother-in-law. Admiral Kimmel had 3 sons. The eldest son that was killed in the war, my dad, and a much younger son, Ned Kimmel, who also fought on Navy ships in World War II. He was on the Vixen and the Ranger, but he strayed badly and went to the Ivy League, graduating from Princeton and Harvard Law School. He is largely responsible for obtaining legislation passed by the Congress in the year 2000, recommending that the President of the United States, in perpetuity, whoever he was then, whoever he or she may be in the future, posthumously nominate Rear Admiral Kimmel and Major General Short to their highest held temporary ranks in World War II of Admiral and Lieutenant General, respectively, in accordance with the Office of Personnel Act of 1947. That recommendation was elevated to law in 2001. Because there are only two officers otherwise qualified in all of the Army and the Navy, otherwise qualified for advancement under the Officer Personnel Act, who have not been so advanced, and that would be Admiral Kimmel and General Short. Ladies and gentlemen, this is probably my favorite photograph of all time, and the reason for it is simple, because I know how difficult it was for the Time Life photographers that took this photograph in 1991 to get both my dad and my uncle smiling at the same time like they are here. This might be the most important slide that I show you, and I say that because in 1984, the then head president of the Pearl Harbor Survivors Association, then a very large organization, summoned my dad and my uncle to a restaurant in New York and asked my dad and my uncle if they would help the Pearl Harbor Survivors Association in their efforts to rehabilitate the reputations of their commanders, Admiral Kimmel and General Short. My dad and my uncle looked at each other and said, "My goodness, if the gentleman who suffered the most from the Pearl Harbor attack won our assistance in this endeavor, who are we to do anything but give our all?" And of course, this is the reason that I'm here. I'm just about my dad's work. The important point with this slide is that the modern initiative to posthumously advance Rear Admiral Kimmel and General Short on the retired list, no money involved, comes not from the Kimmel family, it comes from the Pearl Harbor Survivors Association. Okay, it's impossible, unfortunately, to have an understanding of the Pearl Harbor story without knowing something about magic. So here's the definition of magic. Magic was a code word for the secret American decoding of Japanese diplomatic and spy communications. The truth of the matter was, magic was the term coined by Admiral Anderson, the then director of Naval Intelligence, to refer to any decrypted Japanese code message. Prior to the Pearl Harbor attack, magic decryptions gave indications of the time, place, reason, and deceit planned to cover the attack. If there is one unassailable fact out of all of the Pearl Harbor investigations, is that Hawaii did not have magic. But of course, Manila had magic. When I say Manila, I mean General MacArthur in the Philippines and Admiral Hart, the Commander-in-Chief of the Asiatic Fleet. They had magic. Of course, Washington, D.C. had magic. The British had magic, because we gave them magic. What is interesting now to learn is that not only did Admiral Kimmel and General Short not have magic, but the man that the President of the United States designated as in charge of internal security for the United States, my former boss, J. Edgar Hoover, he didn't have access to magic. And we've also learned that the man the President of the United States designated for responsibility for external security of the United States, Colonel William Wild Bill Donovan, the coordinator of information, eventually the head of the Office of Strategic Services, think the Central Intelligence Agency. He didn't have access to magic. But what we have only recently learned, and we have good reason to believe it, the Soviets, Stalin, had access to magic. Why do I say that? Well, I say that because when I was the assistant agent in charge of the Philadelphia FBI division in 1993 with responsibility for espionage, counter-espionage, counterintelligence, we had wondered why Soviet illegals, that's the term for the real spies, were coming to Minersville, Pennsylvania, a small town with virtually nothing going for it except a little league team. Why were they coming to Minersville, Pennsylvania? Soviet illegals, two of them, regularly coming to Minersville, Pennsylvania in the 1960s. Why? agents puzzled over that. They put a full court press on it. They never did figure it out, but they cataloged all of their investigation, which became critical 30 years later. I'm fortunate enough to be in the Philadelphia division of the FBI when Vasily Matroykin defects from the KGB. He was an archivist in the KGB. He defected with a treasure trove of stolen documents from the KGB. One of those documents identified the reason the Soviet illegals were coming through Minersville, Pennsylvania, in the early 1960s. They were coming there to service a spy in NSA by the name of Robert Lipka. Through some extraordinary work by a couple of very talented agents in the Philadelphia FBI division, we were actually able to make an espionage case against Robert Lipka 30 years after the fact. Why do I tell you that? I tell you that to tell you this. Not only did Vasily Matroykin give us this obviously very good information that we acted upon, he also gave us information that Stalin had access to magic. But that's not all. In 2005, Guy Liddell, the head of counter-espionage for MI5, his diary was made public. In that diary, he makes clear, well before the Pearl Harbor attack, he would send his lieutenant down to GCHQ, think British NSA, Government Code and Cipher School, British NSA. Guy Liddell would send his lieutenant down to GCHQ to smarten up on the Japanese dispatches, which they were breaking. That lieutenant was one of the famous Cambridge spies, Anthony Blunt. It doesn't take much to extrapolate that into access for the NKVD at that time, which was the predecessor of KGB, that they had access to whatever it was Anthony Blunt got out of GCHQ. Okay, this business of magic is so important to the Pearl Harbor story, it's much more than merely not sharing it with Admiral Kimmel. Admiral Kimmel was actually affirmatively misled by this. And I can think of no one better to explain it than his junior counsel.
On Oahu, the naval and army commanders heard nothing of the Japanese reactions to the embargoes. They were advised that although the bans were enforced, no hostile reaction by Japan was expected.
No one can get out of the way.
Hanafi believes was badly served.
Pearl Harbor did not have the purple machine, which was necessary to intercept the critical Japanese diplomatic messages. As a consequence, Kimmel was dependent upon Washington to get him that type of intelligence. From time to time, he received messages indicating that he was getting some of the intercepts. He expected that he would get all of that type of information, which affected his disposition. He had specifically asked for intelligence information that bore upon his problem of defense of the fleet and the base, and he'd been assured he was going to get it. So the absence of the machine and the sporadic intercepts which he got lulled him into a false security in the belief he was getting the intelligence which he needed, and he wasn't.
It's time to hear from the old man himself.
We needed one thing which our own resources could not make available to us. That night vital need was the information available in Washington from the intercepted dispatches, which told when and where Japan would probably strike. I did not get this information.
Ladies and gentlemen, here's the real story within the Pearl Harbor story. 9 days after the Pearl Harbor attack, the President of the United States selected a sitting Supreme Court Associate Justice Owen Roberts to investigate the Army and the Navy only, and then only in Hawaii. 10 days after the Pearl Harbor attack, Admiral Kimmel and General Short were fired and replaced. 11 days after the Pearl Harbor attack, Justice Roberts began his deliberations. He investigated for a grand total of 36 days. 47 days after the Pearl Harbor attack, he filed a report, sent it to the President of the United States, who signed it, changed nothing, immediately gave it to the press, declaring that Admiral Kimmel and General Short were solely blamable for the success of the Japanese attack and derelict in their duty. 47 days after the Pearl Harbor attack. End of the story. Soup to nuts. And that would have been the end of the story. 47 days after the Pearl Harbor attack. But for this man, Captain Lawrence Safford, the head of Op 20G, the head of Naval Communications Intelligence, indeed the revered father of Naval Communications Intelligence. Captain Safford, on February 21st, 1944, years after the Roberts Commission, went to visit my grandfather in Bronxville, New York. He was living in disgrace, a beaten, despondent man. Captain Safford, at great personal risk to himself, met Admiral Kimmel and asked him, "Admiral, did you have available to you in Hawaii the same information we had available to us in the Office of Naval Intelligence in Washington, D.C., from the secret decoding of Japanese diplomatic and spy communications, which gave us indications prior to the attack, Admiral, of the time, place, reason, and deceit plan to cover the attack? Did you have that available to you in a program we called MAGIC?" Admiral Kimmel looked at Captain Safford and said, "Captain, what are you talking about? What is MAGIC?" Captain Safford explained. He identified the messages. The information went from Admiral Kimmel to his counsel, who gave it to the junior member of his counsel, Ed Hanafy, the gentleman you heard just a moment ago. Admiral Kimmel turned into a fighting tiger that very day. He went from a beaten, despondent man into a fighting tiger. He got himself legal representation out of Boston. Charles Rugg was the lead attorney. Ed Hanafy was the junior attorney. Ed Hanafy wrote the enabling legislation using Safford's information, which he took to the Naval Affairs Committee. The Naval Affairs Committee was so impressed with what they saw, they took it to the full Congress. And the full Congress passed a law ordering the Army and the Navy to conduct further investigations, or there would have been no further investigation 47 days after the Pearl Harbor attack. You're going to have to indulge me a little bit, because I'm going to quote, and it's important to get the quote accurate. The first investigation you see up there, number one, the Knox investigation, really is all you need to know about the Pearl Harbor story. Secretary Knox, 2 days after the Pearl Harbor attack, went out, investigated for 4 or 5 days, filed a report in a week. That report was available to the Roberts Commission, and it was not made available to Kimmel or Short during the Roberts Commission proceedings. This is what was in Secretary of Knox's report. I quote, "Neither Short nor Kimmel at the time of the attack had any knowledge of the plain intimations of some surprise move made clear in Washington through the interception of Japanese instructions to Ambassador Nomura, in which a surprise move of some kind was clearly indicated by the insistence upon the precise time of Nomura's reply to Secretary of State Cordell Hull at 1 o'clock on Sunday afternoon, Eastern Standard Time." a message of warning sent from the War Department on Saturday night at midnight. Sent from the War Department on Saturday night at midnight before the attack failed to reach General Short until after the attack. He continued, the best means of defense against an air attack consists of fighter planes. Lack of an adequate number of aircraft available for the defense of the island is due to the diversion of this type before the war to the British, to the Chinese, the Dutch, and the Russians. Again, Knox's report was known to Chairman Roberts, but was not revealed to Kimmel and Short. The Roberts Commission, investigation number two. Here is the dark heart of the Roberts matter. The Washington High Command falsely testified to the Roberts Commission that Kimmel and Short had the same magic information in Hawaii as they had in Washington, D.C. This false information was calculated to do and did Kimmel and Short irreparable prejudice. The Washington High Command had an obligation as officers and decent human beings to rectify the prejudice to Kimmel and Short from such deplorable misinformation. They did not do so. Investigation number three, Safford revealed magic to the Hart investigation. Investigation number four, the Army Pearl Harbor Board. Admiral Kimmel revealed magic to the Army Pearl Harbor Board after General Marshall lied to the Army Pearl Harbor Board, committed perjury to the Army Pearl Harbor Board, and suborned perjury of his lieutenants to the Army Pearl Harbor Board. No wonder the Army Pearl Harbor Board was so critical of General Marshall. I can tell you, investigators do not like to be lied to. Investigation number five, the Naval Court of Inquiry. Of the 10 14 investigations you see there, how many of them accorded Admiral Kimmel the opportunity to defend himself, the opportunity to call and cross-examine witnesses? Anybody? Number five, the Naval Court of Inquiry. That was the only tribunal that accorded Admiral Kimmel the opportunity to defend himself. No wonder the Naval Court of Inquiry virtually exonerated Admiral Kimmel and criticized Admiral Kimmel's only uniformed boss in the Navy, the Chief of Naval Operations, Admiral Stark. Investigation six, seven, and eight tinkered at the margins. Investigation number nine found there was no dereliction of duty. Investigation number 10 is particularly important. It's by the Army Board for Correction of Military Records. General Short had a son, a West Point graduate, who petitioned the Army Board for Correction of Military Records in 1991. The board heard the matter and found injustice and recommended advancement of General Short, only to have it overturned by higher authority without an alternative finding of fact. Investigation number 11 was the one that my uncle and my dad worked so hard to obtain. That one requires some attention. It resulted in the Dorn Report. The Dorn Report recognized that responsibility for the success of the Japanese attack should be broadly shared. This is the first time such a finding was made, 54 years after the attack. But of course, responsibility has not been shared. It is unconscionable to continue to punish Kimmel and Short once that concept has been accepted. Advancing Kimmel and Short does not diminish their command accountability and responsibility any more than ignoring the command accountability and responsibility of Kimmel and Short's superiors diminishes theirs. Investigations 12, 13, and 14, suffice it to say, they're going on right now. So here's the real story within the Pearl Harbor story. My grandfather's determination to get the facts of the Pearl Harbor story before the American public. And of course, He directly caused 8 of these investigations. The 11th was caused directly by my uncle and my dad. Investigations 12, 13, and 14 were caused mainly by my cousin Manning Kimmel in Rock Hill, South Carolina, and myself. Admiral Kimmel took over the Pacific Fleet on February 1st, 1941. His predecessor was fired. 17 days after he took over, he wrote a letter to his only uniformed boss in the Navy, Chief of Naval Operations, Admiral Stark, in which he says, "Admiral Stark, I have recently been told by an officer fresh from Washington, D.C., Admiral Brown, that the Office of Naval Intelligence considers it the function of operations to furnish me, the Commander-in-Chief of the Pacific, with information of a secret nature. I have heard also that operations considers the responsibility for furnishing the same type of information to be that of the Office of Naval Intelligence. Admiral Stark, I do not know that we've missed anything out here in the Pacific, but if there is any doubt as to whose responsibility it is to keep me, the Commander-in-Chief of the Pacific, fully informed with pertinent reports on subjects which should be of interest to the fleet, will you kindly fix that responsibility so there will be no misunderstanding?" Stark answered Kimmel in a letter on March 22nd, in which he said, "Fear not, Admiral Kimmel, the head of the Office of Naval Intelligence at that time, Captain Kirk, is fully aware of his responsibility keeping you adequately informed." Not satisfied with that, in June, Kimmel wrote another letter to his only uniformed boss in the Navy, Chief of Naval Operations, Admiral Stark, in which he says, "Admiral Stark, the Commander-in-Chief of the Pacific Fleet is in a very difficult position. I am far removed from the seat of government, not informed as to policy reflected in current events. Accordingly, it is suggested that it be made a cardinal principle that the Commander-in-Chief of the Pacific Fleet be immediately informed of all important developments as they occur and by the quickest secure means available." Admiral Kimmel got on a plane, flew from Hawaii to Washington, D.C., and had a sit-down with Chief of Naval Operations Stark, handed him that letter, and once again received all sorts of assurances that he would be kept appropriately and adequately informed. The Joint Congressional Committee later asked Admiral Stark why in the world he thought Kimmel was receiving magic if Kimmel was standing before him virtually begging for this type of information. Stark had no answer. I mentioned something about an investigation. Let's start somewhere. Where would we start with an investigation? Anybody? How about we start with the Chief of Naval Operations? And that's what the Joint Congressional Committee did. The General Counsel, William Mitchell, put Admiral Stark under oath, promised to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, and asked him the question, "Admiral, who was it that told you they had a system out in Honolulu or Pearl Harbor of decoding and decrypting Japanese messages?" It took Admiral Stark about 2 nanoseconds to cough up his operations officer, the Chief of Naval War Plans, Admiral Turner. Next step in the investigation. Bet. Let's get Admiral Turner on the stand. Let's ask him, as Congressman Murphy did. "Admiral Turner, did you ever tell Admiral Stark that Admiral Kimmel was getting that information, that magic information?" Admiral Turner, being an honorable man, said, "Yes, sir, on 3 occasions. I asked Admiral Noyes, the Chief of Naval Communications, about it, and so reported back to Admiral Stark." Admiral Turner went on to testify that he went through this exercise on 3 occasions. The first time was in January of 1941, actually 1 month before Kimmel even took the job. The second time was in July or August of 1941, and the third time was in November of 1941, all with the same outrageously wrong results, reporting back to Chief of Naval Operations Stark that Kimmel was getting this magic information. Next step in the investigation. Got to be Admiral Noyes, doesn't it? Let's get Admiral Noyes on the stand, swear him in, and ask him the $64 question. Actually, it was question 64 by the Naval Court of Inquiry. Did you, Admiral Noyes, ever inform the Chief of War Plans Division, Captain Turner, that the commander of the Pacific Fleet was decrypting intelligence information of a character similar to that which you were receiving in the Navy Department? In other words, magic. And Admiral Noyes responded, how many yes? How many no? Ladies and gentlemen, I can tell you, after 25 years as an FBI investigator, when your investigation reaches this point, you have reached nothing less than an investigative epiphany. There's nowhere else for your investigation to go. You now know why we were surprised at Pearl Harbor. But there's a lot more to the story. This was the highlight of the Joint Congressional Committee investigation, the biggest of the investigations. Commander Lester Scholes was a courier for the 14-part Japanese response, which we were decoding before the Japanese were. It was a response that the Japanese were giving to a November 26, 1941 American note from Secretary of State Cordell Hull to the Japanese. That American note, in effect, said, Japan, get out of China or else. From the secret decoding of these Japanese messages, we knew that they considered that an ultimatum, a humiliating proposal, and a proposal that in no way they could use for further negotiations. So they told their ambassador in Washington that they were sending a 14-part response, which they wanted the ambassador to prepare in nice form. They were sending the response in English. No need to translate the 14-part response. It was in formal, excellent English. Obviously, Japan was making a statement for history, attempting to justify for history what they were about to do. When the 13th part of that response came in, Commander Scholes took it to the President of the United States, according to his testimony before the Joint Congressional Committee, and handed it to the President. And President Roosevelt read it and said, this means war. He turned to his number one confidant, Harry Hopkins, and Harry Hopkins agreed, this means war. The whole tenor of the investigations changed forever after. Now investigators wondered, would it be possible for the commander-in-chief, the President of the United States, to read a secret communication from the enemy, declare this means war, and not immediately reach out to the head of his army and the head of his navy? Investigators wanted to know that. So they tried to find out. They put General Marshall on the stand. And General Marshall, with his photographic memory, according to President Truman, was asked, General Marshall, where were you Saturday evening, December 6th, when your only boss was declaring this means war after reading a secret communication from the enemy? Where were you, sir? Anybody remember? I don't recall. A blank slate, has no recollection, can't remember. Okay, General, where were you Sunday morning when there was still plenty of time to warn our armed forces worldwide of the threat, especially after the notification that the 14-part message was to be delivered precisely at 1 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 7:30 a.m. Hawaii time. Where were you, sir? Well, he didn't have any independent recollection of where he was, but his routine was to ride his horse in Rock Creek Park on Sunday morning, so that's what he must have been doing. Investigators now are getting pretty frustrated. They say, okay, General, you don't remember where you were Saturday night. You don't have independent recollection of what you were doing Sunday morning. Where were you, sir, when you actually got the word that Pearl Harbor was under attack? I understand in the audience there might be one or two people of the appropriate age. So let me ask you, if I'm correct, and there is somebody of the appropriate age in the audience, do you recall where you were when you got the word that Pearl Harbor was under attack on December 7th, 1941? Thank you. I am not of your number. I was born in 1943, but I assure you, I know exactly where I was when I got the word President Kennedy had been shot. I was in physics class at the Naval Academy and remember it like it was yesterday. Let me ask you one more question. Do you remember where you were on September 11th, 2001, when you got the word that the once you get rolling, you know, that the World Trade Center was under attack? General Marshall, you with the prime responsibility of warning our armed forces worldwide of the threat, where were you, sir, when you actually got the word that Pearl Harbor was under attack? I'm not making this up, folks. You can find that in Volume 3 of the Joint Congressional Committee's Pearl Harbor Attack Volumes at page 1,109. But I'm more interested in the Navy end of this thing, not the Army end of it. So let's take a look at that. Admiral Stark, where were you, sir, when your only boss was reading that secret communication from the enemy and declaring this means war? The Joint Congressional Committee wanted to know that. And on January 2nd, 1946, Admiral Stark was sworn in and given that question. And his response was, I don't know where I was. The next day, they asked him the same question. He hung tough. I don't know where I was. One of the congressmen, the Joint Congressional Committee, asked him, Admiral Stark, could you have been with General Marshall, since he can't remember either? Admiral Stark actually had this amazing reply. I think we had no such conspiracy at that time, sir. Okay, from the slide. A week after Admiral Stark's performance, a little more than a week, the Joint Congressional Committee ended their investigation. It's over. They shut down. Time to write the report. Investigation is over. A week after that, Admiral Stark's flag lieutenant, Captain Harold Crick, went to the admiral and said, Admiral Stark, don't you remember where you were, sir, Saturday evening, December 6th, 1941? You were with me, sir. You were with me and our wives. We went to the National Theater in Washington, D.C. We saw a performance of The Student Prince. When it was over, we retired to your quarters at the National Observatory, at the Naval Observatory. When we walked in, the butler immediately informed you that the President of the United States had called you and wanted you to return the call. You excused yourself, went to your library, came back shortly thereafter, and said you had been talking with the President of the United States about the critical situation in the Pacific. Don't you remember that, Admiral? Admiral Stark, now between the devil and the deep blue sea, went back to the head of the Joint Congressional Committee and said, maybe we better do something about this. The Joint Congressional Committee head, now between a rock and a hard place, agreed. So they reconvened the Joint Congressional Committee and took the testimony of Harold Crick. And then they asked Admiral Stark once again, under oath, if his memory had been in any way refreshed. And Stark said it had not. They asked Captain Crick, how come you can remember and Admiral Stark cannot? And Admiral Crick said the obvious thing. You don't forget that sort of thing. I've been trying to hide it, ladies and gentlemen. But by now, in my presentation, I've gotten a little exercised. And it's time for me to cool off a bit. And I found it's helpful to to seek counsel from one of my favorites and one of the greats of all time. It helps me lighten up a little bit. And certainly Vince Lombardi had a marvelous way with words, a motivator supreme. So Vince, what have you got for me? How was that, Vince? I am sure Admiral Kimmel's thinking was somewhat akin to Vince's there, especially when he received a letter from the Chief of Naval Operations, Admiral Stark, in 1944. Admiral Kimmel penned a draft response, and he started off by saying, "I, Admiral Kimmel, am astounded that you could and would write to me such a letter as that of yours of 12 December, and I can easily see why no one could have greater satisfaction than you upon the publication of the decision that there was no grounds for court-martial for Pearl Harbor." And then he went on. "You, Admiral Stark, betrayed the men of the fleet by not giving them a fighting chance for their lives. You betrayed me by not giving me information you knew I was entitled to. You betrayed me by your acquiescence in the action taken on the request for my retirement. You betrayed yourself. You betrayed yourself by misleading the Roberts Commission as to what information had been sent to me. You betrayed yourself by your self-serving lapse of memory before the Naval Court of Inquiry. I hope that you never communicate with me again and that I never see you or hear or see your name again, that my memory may not be refreshed of one so despicable as you." And on that high note, folks, I'm finished. Thank you very much for your kind attention. You want to hear any more of this? This is my speaking schedule. It's updated on my website all the time. Dick Hyde will be prominently mentioned again in my next talk down the road here, day after tomorrow, I guess it is. I take questions or not? Admiral Kimmel's written. Am I going to write a book? Is the question. I haven't written a book. I've written several articles. They appear on my website. If you have trouble with it, see Dick Hyde. No, actually, give me an email and I'll send it to you direct if you have trouble getting it. But there are several articles. I haven't written a book. Admiral Kimmel has written a book. It's a very good book, and it's available for nothing on my website. He wrote it in 1954. He followed it up with a wonderful writing in 1962. And then I've added to it with some information that we found from the FBI, from J. Edgar Hoover. All of that's available on my website. Sir, yes, sir.
You describe what in my mind can be characterized as perfidy. I'm wondering, do you know why?
Did I hear the word perfidy?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Sure. One of my favorite words. It means treachery.
Yes,
yeah. The question is why did they lie to the Roberts Commission? And then once they lied or recognized that they gave misinformation, let's be nice about it, I wasn't lying, I just didn't know. Eventually they found out that they had given misinformation, then why didn't they come forward and say they had given misinformation?
But I'm talking about before that. Why did they not give them the information? Give the information.
You're trying to get me to use the C word. I'm an FBI agent. I don't use the C word lightly.
Well, other words that describe it.
Stupidity describes it. I think I've proven stupidity. I can prove stupidity. What I can't prove is cupidity, or that other C word that you're trying to get me to say. Yes, sir.
Possibly having some
The question is, how come I haven't mentioned the famous transoceanic interception by the German postal authorities, giving it to the head of the Gestapo chief, Heinrich Mueller, which was publicized in a book in 1995 by a fellow with many aliases. I know this fellow well. I have examined the transcript with great care. I have co-authored a monograph about that. It's not on my website because there are some proprietary interest in the writing. However, if I've been told by the publishers with the proprietary interest that if a friend of mine asks me for it, I can give it to him. So if you send me an email and say something about the fact that you're my friend, I'll send you the monograph. But the short of it is, in my opinion, it's a fraud. I could be wrong. And no one has a greater interest in it being wrong than I do. I mean, I'm a receptive person here, but I know the author of that thing extremely well. Talk to him every day for well nigh 10 years. And my conclusion is it's a fraud.
Let me make myself clear. It is your opinion that it is a fraud that possibly Roosevelt and Churchill, I hate to use the word conspired, but related to each other, the fact that they knew of this intelligence and did nothing about it.
No, I'm not saying it like that because I don't know. What I do think I know is this transcript. And only the transcript am I addressing in such a negative way. There's plenty of reason to believe that Churchill and Roosevelt got together and worked these things out. I have a whole, I don't know if you've read the other talks that I have, but one of them is advanced knowledge. I have a whole talk on all the indications of advanced knowledge. If you want to hear it someday, it's longer than this talk by quite a bit. And it still leaves one, me, with reasonable doubt. It's not proven. And I don't need to prove that Roosevelt did such a Machiavellian thing to seek the relief that I seek. So I stay away from that. I appreciate your thoughts on that very much. There's actually a monograph that argues that speech was written before the Pearl Harbor attack. That's an interesting monograph to read.
My question was about Roosevelt pressuring these people. Possibly that was what my question was.
The question is, why would they deliberately frame Admiral Kimmel? And I have an answer to that one. It comes not from me, but from the Chief of Naval Operations, Admiral King. Admiral King, after all was said and done, and the war and the investigations were over, he was interviewed, and he said Admiral Kimmel was sold down the river as a political expedient. Simple as that. That's absolutely a quote. I can give you a citation of it. Send me an email, I'll give you a citation. It's a marvelous quote. The best quote about the whole Pearl Harbor situation that I'm aware of comes from Admiral Nimitz. Admiral Nimitz was the admiral who replaced my grandfather. Admiral Nimitz, this is one of the things that really got me going, doing what I do. When I was a senior at the Naval Academy, I read Admiral Nimitz's textbook. It was called Sea Power. It's a wonderful book, written by Potter and Nimitz, a collaboration which was marvelous. And on page 641, Nimitz says, Admiral Kimmel was given no information which would justify interrupting a very urgent training schedule. Let that one sink in. I mean, that was what he was doing out there. He was trying to prepare the fleet for war, which was hopelessly unprepared for war. He knew it. Everybody else knew it. That was his job. Admiral Kimmel was given no information which would justify interrupting a very urgent training schedule.
Sir?
Yes, sir. The question is, how come Admiral Halsey's aircraft carrier was not in Pearl Harbor? And there's a pretty good reason for that. Admiral Halsey was probably the biggest supporter of Admiral Kimmel for the remainder of his life. Admiral Halsey, all right. When Admiral Kimmel took over on February 1st, 1941, he had four aircraft carriers. In April and May of 1941, the Yorktown, which was one of the four, was sent to the Atlantic, along with several auxiliaries. Admiral Kimmel lost 25% of his fleet then. He lost more of his fleet in April and May of 1941 than was lost during the Pearl Harbor attack. He's now down to three aircraft carriers. Saratoga was on the West Coast, undergoing overhaul repairs. That left two aircraft carriers. Halsey in Enterprise and Newton in Lexington. The day after the famous November 27, 1941 war warning message from Washington, D.C., the Navy Department, Chief of Naval Operations Stark, sent Kimmel a suggestion to reinforce Wake and Midway Islands with Army fighter planes. Indeed, with 50% of General Short's fighter planes in Hawaii. This is a day after the war warning message. Kimmel thought reinforcing Wake and Midway was a good idea. So that's what he did. He ordered Halsey in Enterprise to reinforce Wake Island. And he ordered Admiral Brown, who was actually Newton's boss, to tell Newton to take Lexington to Midway and reinforce Midway. And that's what they were doing when Pearl Harbor was attacked. Why in the world Yamamoto went ahead with the attack when the prime targets were no longer there is a question for history that's so far unanswered. The head of the 14th Naval District, Admiral Block, who was formerly Commander-in-Chief of the Pacific, and was the Navy representative primarily responsible for the defense of the fleet and defense of Pearl Harbor when the fleet was in Pearl Harbor, actually said the Japanese did us a favor sinking those old battleships. What an unbelievable statement that is, but it's true. He abhorred the loss of life, 2,403 men dead without a fighting chance. He deplored that, but the Japanese did us a favor sinking the battleships. Now we had all kinds of men to go man the important ships. They didn't go after the submarines that were in Pearl Harbor. The submarines were primarily responsible for winning the war. It's not me saying this, it was Tojo. Before we hung him, they asked him, how come, Premier Tojo, why do you think the Americans beat the Japanese? And he listed fast carrier attacks, not in any particular order, He listed island hopping tactics and attrition of shipping, Japanese shipping from submarines. Those are the three reasons. I think I'm getting a little, I mean, I may need more from Vince here in a minute. Yes, sir. Yeah, well, yeah, as a general proposition, I agree with that statement. I'm thinking right now of the commander of the Indianapolis, McVeigh, who actually was court-martialed. Sure, political expediency, just like... I couldn't agree more with that.
By not raising the question during the war, creating dissension.
Yes, ma'am. The answer is yes. It's funny you should ask that because I did a damage assessment on an FBI spy. And I needed information out of the CIA, and the FBI said, well, the CIA isn't going to give it to you. So I went to the CIA and said, can I have that information? The CIA said, sure. So I went back to the FBI and said, hey. Yes, I have. Yes, ma'am.
Is it true that Churchill wanted to meet Franklin Roosevelt, get into the war, to help him out, and Roosevelt said they have to attack us first? So they talked about it, and that's why they held back, Roosevelt held back doing anything until he could get the messages from Japan. They were going to attack us, and they went ahead and let them attack so we could get into the war to please Churchill.
I'm gratified to be able to respond promptly, as Mark Twain said. I don't know. I have to recognize him. Yes, sir. What a great question. I wish I had gotten that one earlier. My dad, my uncle certainly did that. And they went to the, who's the vice president? Cheney, Dick Cheney. I can't remember everything, folks. My uncle, came across a constituent letter to then Secretary of Defense Dick Cheney. Cheney, that's the way he pronounces it. The constituent asked Secretary of Defense Cheney, in effect, what are you going to do for Admiral Kimmel? And Secretary Cheney wrote a very nice letter back saying, hey, if the Kimmel family is serious about this, I want them to do four, they should do four things. And he lists the four things. Well, we got a hold of this constituent letter, and the four things were this. Number one, get the Pearl Harbor Survivors Association to write a formal recommendation for advancement of Kimmel and Short. Number two, get the voices of the time, World War II veterans who are still living, this is 1991, and get them to, in writing, embrace the initiative advancement. And number three, seek out Arleigh Burke, the former Chief of Naval Operations, Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, and apparently a confidant of Secretary Cheney, and get his personal endorsement of this. And after you've done those three things, then seek out the vote of the United States Senate. So my uncle and my dad looked at each other when they got a hold of that constituent's letter, and they said, okay, here we go. So they did all those things. And they have a famous letter to President Bush, 41, with 36 admirals, 33 of them four-star admirals, recommending that this initiative be taken. Arleigh Burke wrote a magnificent letter. I could not have written it any better myself. Arleigh Burke said, I recommend, Mr. Secretary, that you take this action, not because of its importance to the Kimmel family, but because of its importance to the Navy as an institution. The Pearl Harbor Survivor State gave us a very specific recommendation for advancement. And then we took it to the Senate. And here's the vote. Here's the vote, the roll call vote in 1999. As you can see, it's close. What I should point out here is that the primary sponsor of the legislation, which eventually passes, and I'll explain that in a minute, Senator Biden of Delaware, the current Vice President of the United States, was the primary sponsor of the bill. The former Secretary of Defense, Chuck Hagel, who just left as Secretary of Defense, you might recall, when he was a senator from Nebraska. He voted for it in 1999. The current Secretary of State, John Kerry, voted for it when he was a senator from Massachusetts in 1999. There are 100 senators. Senator McCain, about 8 years my senior at the Naval Academy. His dad was Commander-in-Chief of the Pacific. My dad worked for him. His grandfather worked for Admiral Kimmel. Senator McCain came to Delaware for several fundraisers. My uncle was particularly in tune with the politics in Delaware, and he would assist in these fundraisers and continuously buttonhole Senator McCain every time he could and ask him, are you with us or against us, Senator? And Senator McCain would continuously say, oh, we're for you all the way. As you can see here, 99 senators voted, Senator McCain did not. In 1991, Senator McCain wrote a very nice letter to the president recommending that he take advantage of the 50th anniversary of Pearl Harbor and advance Admiral Kimmel, nominate him for posthumous advancement. I have that letter. I recently wrote to Senator McCain reminding him of the letter that he wrote in 1991. If you'd like to read that letter and read Senator McCain's letter, go to my website. It's readily available on the website. I am waiting for a response from Senator McCain. I'm gonna stop. If we can get the president, whoever he is now, wherever he or she may be in the future, to make this nomination, it would go to the Senate Armed Services Committee. This is who's on the Senate Armed Services Committee. Obviously, John McCain, now with the midterm elections, is now the head of it, very important in the proceedings. I looked mightily for somebody from Georgia, but I didn't see anybody who was on the Senate Armed Services Committee. But that does not mean that it wouldn't be a good idea to get the Georgia senators who are Thought I had him here. Well, anyway, if you get on their website, embedded website, and ask them what they're going to do for Admiral Kimmel, it's the 75th anniversary is coming up soon. This time my wife wants me to be quiet, so that's the end of it.
Mr. Kimball, please, sir, accept this as just a small token of our appreciation. And I have heard every word you said, and I think you've done this before.
And I hope to do it again, yes, sir.
Thank you. If you have six more speeches, we got more openings for you, okay? I think everyone enjoyed that, did you not? It is without a doubt one of the best answer and question and answer periods we've had. And sir, I appreciate your dedication to your grandfather. Also, thank you for your service to your country. You're a true American. Thank you so much.